Hello. Hi. I'll sit down. So, I'm Mark. I'm Sis. I work at Cliff upstairs. Do front end development. We build a lot of component pattern libraries for clients. I do a bit of kind of tech consulting, like on the architecture kind of side of things. And I build a lot of internal tools as well in my sort of downtime. So, I think today I'm going to be touching on sort of a little bit of all those different things, mostly component libraries. There's lots of names and language around the sort of things that I want to talk about today. Lots of words, basically. Style guides, patterns, components, things like that. I don't like a lot of these words. I think a lot of these words have got connotations which I try and avoid. Like style guides, for instance, I think they've got a lot of baggage with them about like old print style guides, kind of PDF documents, more about how you're, you know, what colours to use and what sort of font sizes to use, which all has a place, but it's not really what I'm talking about today. Patterns is a very common sort of term for these sort of things. I don't like patterns because I think that it implies repetition, and I think that when you're talking about a component library, you might be splitting something up into sort of modular code, modular pieces of code, and there's value in that whether it's repeated or not. Obviously, there is value in it being repeated if you're going to take like a piece of code and you're going to use that on multiple pages or whatever, but there's also value in that just on the kind of modularization of that. It's got JavaScript to do with it, it's got CSS to do with it. So I try and avoid patterns, I do use it all the time, but I try and avoid it. Instead, I kind of like to focus on calling them components and component libraries. So I'll try and refer to that throughout the talk. I'll probably talk, use all the other words as well, but that's what I generally try and stick to. Now, there's one problem with that, is that when I say components, people always think, I mean React. I don't mean React. I'm not a React developer. I don't know that much about React. I'd quite like to know more about React. I'm not anti-React, and certainly React components are a type of component, but they're not really the kind of component that I'm talking about today. I'm trying to talk about components and component libraries, hopefully in a kind of language agnostic and a template language agnostic kind of manner. So, what is a component library? I guess people are here because they've generally heard of them, know them, use them. But I think it's worth kind of going through like, what we're talking about here. This is a component library. This is what the popular kind of examples of these sort of things is. This is a MailChimp UX, ux.mailchimp.com. Yeah, there you see a bunch of list of all the different bits of their system. So you sort of assume these are the bits that make up their site. You get a rendering here of something which that component is rendered in the browser. You see a bit of code here, some HTML that you can copy and paste in theory with their CSS file, and it should render like that and some notes and stuff. There's another one, Lightning Design System, again, really nice kind of example. Similar format, stuff down the side. HTML, render components, they've got this idea of variants and states there, which are different variations on this like base pattern, base component. And then this is an old JLF project a little while ago. Again, same sort of stuff, components, HTML, preview, pretty standard sort of stuff. So a lot of people, when they think about component libraries, think about this. It's like web, this UI kind of layer. It's a place where I can preview individual bits of my site and app and see the code that's used to create them. That's useful if you're trying to share code between, you want consistency between different sites, using the same code between sites, stuff like that. Some people said that. That's definitely a real question. Alternatively, you can think of it like this, a bunch of files. Now, this is obviously not terribly helpful, but this is actually how I prefer to think about component libraries. Because for me, a component library isn't it's not the UI over the top of it, it's not how you browse it. It's this for me is a component library. All this stuff here, it's a directory full of files that are organized in some way that have been split up according to the needs of my application into, I've probably got template files here, I'm not doing what plain HTML, but some sort of markup, some sort of styling, some sort of JavaScript, potentially. But it's just a file system of stuff which my app has been broken up into. Might be a repository, which I'll look at later as well. It might be a repository, it might not be. But I try and get away from thinking about the component library itself as being the rendering over the top of the component library, so I think it's quite useful to think about it in that way. So I would define a component in this really horribly wordy way, but it's a generic term to define a piece of the website UI. simple static HTML element, a whole page, or probably something in between. But it could be any of those things. So I like to kind of keep it quite broad with the definition of component. And it's not just markup, because I think the component should encompass all the things that render that component, or the systems or the tools we're going to talk about. Think of it in terms of component being the HTML, or component being the styles that render that HTML. But I think all the things, the tests, the documentation, everything like that, those are all the constituent parts of the component. I think it's good to try and tie those all together. And then a component library is just a collection of those components, hopefully organized in a meaningful manner. Now, I haven't mentioned in there, again, anything about the UI or anything like that. It's just describing this system that we've got here. I'll come on to a bit more why later. So, some tools and techniques for generating pattern libraries. Those might be familiar with a lot of these. I'm trying to skim through them, but... start with these, I think it's slightly an outlay. You've got these SAS applications for generating component level pattern libraries and style guides, whatever you like. So, Frontify lets you create something quite nice, like nice looking, very easy to create this sort of stuff. Got colours, this is a sort of style guide thing about how, you know, what colours you've got in there, what colours you should use. It's got downloadable assets, some tips on how to use stuff. You've got more like the component library that we were looking at earlier, where you've got codes, you've got the rendering of that code and stuff. And you put all that together with like a wiki, it's basically like a wiki, it's like kind of Google Docs. You click on these things, you can add this into your page. And if you want to add code into the page, you get a nice little kind of code pen style, like editor type thing. It's quite nice, it's a nice application to use, very nice. I don't really like this as a way to build up component libraries, because for me this doesn't have what I was just talking about, it doesn't have that code on my system. Yeah, it's a nice way, it's a very good way if you want to share things quickly, it's online, you can edit from anywhere, but it doesn't have, I don't have code payload on my system. I have no idea how people build their sites from this, their actual sites from this. Then you've got style sheet passes, so there's things like hologram, KSS, Style Docker, I think, is another one. GitHub used something like this. This basically takes, you write some comments. Look, just want to see it. You basically have your CSS files, or SAS, or LESS, or whatever. You add some structured metadata up the top, and then you point, these ones are Ruby gems, you point them at your kind of application, and it generates a whole bunch of documentation from that. These are quite useful if you've already got an application and someone says, now we need to generate a style guide from our application, because you kind of don't need to change the structure of your application that much. You can just literally add in comments into your CSS, your SAS, that sort of stuff. So it's quite a good way, it's kind of, you know, a very simple, quick way to get that stuff. This fills me a little bit with fear, I have to say, because, like, I write comments all the time for my JavaScript, my functions, stuff like that, and guaranteed that if you look at any of my comments, they're all out of date compared to my actual functions and stuff. If you change something in your CSS, these kind of inert bits of metadata, you have to be quite disciplined to actually update those at the same time as you update your other stuff. And the thought of actually having HTML blocks in my CSS makes me a little bit, uncomfortable. Because now I need to not only update my comments when I update my CSS, but I also need to update my comments when I update my HTML. I think they have a good use case, but if I was starting building a component library today, that's probably not the thing I would start with. You also can't template out your HTML, so if you want to kind of produce other variants of that one, you want to show it with this image and then another image, you just have to kind of copy and paste that in there. So it's useful, but again, it's not kind of how I like to start. And this is a component library generator, one of those things, this is GitHub's actual one which they've got their own on there. On the CSS.io. Then you get static site generators. So static site generators are things people know about stuff like Jekyll. They're basically specialized forms of Jekyll. You can use Jekyll to create a pattern library as well. People do. But they're kind of like that. They take a directory of stuff, which is what I said I liked before, and these kind of things are definitely more and more wheelhouse. It's kind of like the way I like to do stuff. But they take a directory of stuff, which has got some rules around how things should be organized. They've got some templating language. Now, there's templating language, this is a pattern lab example that has to be moustached pattern lab. Other ones use handlebars, and these particular field tools or whatever. But they basically turn that into an ICUI. So they'll pass that, apply some rules, they'll spit out the other end, some static HTML, CSS, some JavaScript, and they generate the UI here. With some navigation, I'm sure people are familiar with Pattern Lab, that kind of thing. And then you can see the code that you need to generate that. You can see that they've generated HTML and a massage template, the actual template underneath it. And this is the Fabricator version, it's very similar. Rendered stuff, you can skin this, I think, to be how you like. Swipe it the wrong way. These are, in my mind, these are better. I think these are definitely a good step. They're taking a kind of directory of stuff, so I've got that stuff to play with, I've got that stuff to implement. They quite often put a lot of restrictions around the way you need to do things, so they might have restrictions on what template language you want to use, how your things should be organized, which may or may not be a good thing. I mean, PattermLab uses Brad Frost's atomic sign methodology. That's really good if you're like, how do I kind of split up my components and that provides a nice framework to be able to do that in. But it might not necessarily suit your project, and quite often we've found building these things that having to shoehorn your own structure into these things is not necessarily the best way to do things. So consequently, a lot of people build bespoke solutions, and I think when a lot of the really nice examples we see, a lot of more integrated examples as well, we see on the web with bespoke solutions. So obviously with a bespoke solution, you can do what you want. You can start with, I've had a paper around the GitHub repos of most of these, but let's do start with, the directory full of code. It's probably a components style directory. We've got a bunch of different components in there. But you can make your own decisions around how those things are organized, around what template language you want to use, how you're going to provide data to those things, all that sort of stuff. So this is the Lightning one, uses React for their components and to render the actual component library itself. And that renders something like this. So it's good because it's tailored to your exact use case. You can make the decisions around this. It's good because often it's built with the next step in mind, the next step being integration, right? How do I now turn this into my site? I'm going to build a site, build an app. I find it quite funny that we kind of ended up slightly in this situation where we're building component libraries to help us build sites, but then the actual act of turning the component library into the site is often this really painful point. We should be building component libraries that can help us to build the site, not just from the kind of point of view of authoring the actual components, but helping to move things through the whole process and into production as well. So if you're building a bespoke thing, you've got much more control about what you're using to build in the templates. It's much easier to move that on to the next step. So that's all bonuses. Now, the downside is that it's a ton of work to build this from scratch. Yeah? There's a lot of stuff that goes into deciding how you're going to organize your stuff, deciding what language you're going to use to do your templates in, how you're going to pass that, how you're going to generate this UI kind of stuff, how you style the UI, and then how you integrate that with your production app. It's a lot of work, but obviously if you're an in-house thing like Salesforce or Lonely Planet, we'll talk about that example in a minute, but it's worth their while to do this and to do it well. This is a Lonely Planet example, which we'll get on to in a minute. Delivering style guides, component libraries. This is kind of like the holy grail. This is what people want to do. They want to build a style guide, a bunch of components, stick it in a directory somewhere, and have that power both their nice preview UI and also actually integrate into their application. So quite often the situation we end up with, when they're not got delivering style guides, is this sort of situation. Is where we've got a bunch of code here, so we're using kind of static site generator, that is kind of tied up with our preview UI, web preview UI, and that is structured around generating this web preview UI. Yeah? So that's this kind of this is, it's kind of like a, I would say, it's a bit like a CMS smell, you know? If you can view the source of the site and tell which CMS is powering it, I call that a bad smell, because I can tell, I shouldn't be able to tell what is underneath, like what the intent of that code was. It should be, honestly, agnostic. But these will generate a kind of component front end. And then we have this at ClearNet. At ClearNet, we typically develop component libraries. We're not in-house. We will develop them, and we will give them almost as developer documentation. So we'll put them on the web somewhere. Then the client will look at them, and they will then do what happens here. Yeah? We browse the patterns, copy, paste into the app proper. So this is the proper app code base. And this is kind of okay if it's a one-time integration. So when we deliver stuff, it's literally like, here's the stuff that you're going to now build your application out of. Copy paste it, and then this might get retemplated. Yeah? So it might be copying HTML out of here, and then retemplating this as Nginx templates or React or whatever it is, which then that gets used for the app. The obvious problem here is that as soon as you retemplate that, as soon as you change that HTML, you've lost the link between these two things. And if you change something here, this is now dead, basically. You can't use this anymore. Or if you change something here, you need to have endless change log hell to kind of make sure that all the changes into the pattern library get migrated in there and down. So it's not really a sustainable solution. It's okay if you're doing a one-off pass integration, but if you want to have something which is going to be an ongoing thing, then you get into this whole living style guide thing. So living style guide, you've got your code base. Your code base is a single source of truth. That's what you use. That's the thing where you're going to make changes. That's the only place you're going to make changes. And then somehow you're going to get that sucked into your kind of UI layer, your rendering UI layer, and your proper app itself. So people have written about this. Sure, you've probably read these articles. They're pretty good. Lonely Planet and the GDS, I think, took quite a similar approach. I thought I'd just basically pick out a few of the different bits of those approaches, those similar bits, just to kind of break it down a little bit. So, got a component repository, got a bunch of files. So, we've got, again, this is the Lightning Design one here. They're using YAML for their configuration data, so they're both providing this component library here is both providing the components themselves, the JSX files, the React files. They're also providing some configuration data, and mostly that's to render those components in a preview setting. So they're rendering that on the preview UI. And that data will then be replaced when it's actually used in the real application. That will be replaced by data out of database or however it is for that particular instance of the component. Then they've got, I call them different things, but it's basically a native component renderer. Now, by native, I mean something which renders a component which is written in the language which the application is written in. Yeah? And it's normally an abstracted thing. So these, I think they both use gems, Ruby gems basically, and they put in this gem, the gems of dependency of the project, and that gem hides all the complexity of finding the component, the appropriate component, and rendering that component in the instance it needs to be used in. So they might have a plain HTML page with a bunch of holes in it, and then they fill it with calls to this Ruby gem, which will then render the appropriate component with the appropriate data. Now, I think this is like a crucial step here, because what they're doing is that they're abstracting away any complexity to do with finding that component, rendering that component out of their applications. And actually, they could probably use these in their app that renders their actual preview UI, their kind of style guide UI as well. So, if they change how, I mean, this might be a real file path, or it might just be a fake file path, I've got absolutely no idea. It might be like more like an ID for those things, but this doesn't sort of dictate how those components are fetched. Those components might be fetched on the file system, it might be fetched from a Git repository, an NPM layer, it might be that the component library itself is an NPM dependency of the app or whatever. I mean, probably not, they're using Ruby, but the thing is, it doesn't matter, and they can change that behind the scenes, and if all their instances of their sites use the same gem, they don't have to worry about where the components are, or how they're found, or how they're rendered. They could use completely different templating languages if they wanted to render the components under the hood. They don't need to be ERB or anything like that. Then you've got an asset loader. An asset loader is typically fancy name for chucking a link style sheet tag in the header, or like a script tag. Assets are really not the hard thing, I think, when it comes to building libraries, because they're static, you generate them once, they're kind of built, you can easily move them around or reference them from other places. It's not difficult. You can wrap it up in some convenience functions or whatever. But generally, it's pretty easy. Assets are kind of easier thing to deal with. And then you've got another bit of this is their component browser app. So this is again what we're talking about. Gov.uk has got a predictably minimalist kind of view of it, this sort of stuff. You click on one of those, you get more details about the component, but this can use the same gems, and it doesn't offer, I've got no idea, but I assume it uses the same gem to find the components. And again, I don't know where those components are stored, and this little rendering app to provide a nice preview layer so people can go in, have a look. Doesn't need to know about where the components are or anything like that. They also expose data about their components in different formats. This is not from Lady Pad or anything, but Lady Pad do a similar thing in that they expose via HTTP data about their components for systems that aren't written in Ruby. So if they've got like a JavaScript app that needs to get a hold of a component, they can make a HTTP call to get the contents of that component, and they can render that like that. We cache it, obviously. But it's a way you can build, if you've got this abstract single source of truth repository, you can then build different interfaces to access the data in that. And then you've got your production application, and again, this just uses that same template resolver, basically, calls in the assets, and there's no logic in here about knowing where the components are. There doesn't have to be any logic in there about finding them or rendering or anything like that. So, it's a little bit complex, but it sounds like it shouldn't be that difficult to do, basically. So why is it so hard? I think that number one, or certainly one of the main things, is poor planning. I think that people start projects where they're like, we're going to redo our application, we're going to do a new site. People say, let's build a style guide, it's like really fashionable, trendy. So they think about how they're going to build that, but they're not thinking about how it's going to fit into the workflow, how it's going to start integrating into the back end. And I think that if you're not planning that stuff from the start, in fact, I think you should probably do the planning the other way around, you are going to get into trouble. I think that we see this quite a lot, silo front-end and back-end teams, that you've got a front-end team, that normally is the developer, front-end developers, but also the designers and stuff like that, work as a kind of nice, tight, cohesive unit. And then they've got, bigger clients, certainly you've got a specific back-end team, and they're building an app in Java with Spring templates or something like that, and the front end team are designing this lovely style guide, it's nice, it's going up, everyone's very happy with it. And then they kind of like just punt it over the wall to the back end. And this manifests itself in loads of different places, not just in this, but I think it's one of the reasons why it's so hard to actually get this nice flow from style guide to production. And then I think there's one of the things which is involved, all these things are kind of involved in each other, but there's a language and tooling mismatch. This ties into both of those, but quite often we find that you've got a back-end team, as I said, maybe they're building something in Java, using Spring templates, that's the way they've always got their app, that's the way they're planning on building the app. And then on the front end, people are using a tool, maybe Fabricator or whatever, that uses, handlebars, for instance, for templating, and maybe Gulp, and maybe the back-end team is using Make for their build tools. And you've got these two kind of like incompatible things. And again, it's this funny situation where you're building this thing to help you build the front end stuff, but then it's so hard to integrate the stuff in the back end that you end up with this copy paste kind of thing, which is, it's not ideal in any situation. I mean, if you've got a mismatch in tooling between the front end and the back end, there's going to be somewhere where you're going to be rewriting code. I think that's what we're trying to avoid. Say you want to build a component library. So I'm not really in this talk talking about like how to take your code base and chop it up into little bits or anything like that. I'm more talking about when you want to come to a component library, you want to plan how you're going to assemble a component library, and some of the things that you might kind of run into, some of the problems you might run into along the way, things to think about like early on. This is really important, I think. So, again, this comes down to planning it straight away, but like planning it up front, doing more planning up front rather than just diving into actually building the thing. But what are you building? It might be about a case that you are building a startup, right? Maybe all you need to know is what colours the, you know, if it, maybe the, it's, it just needs to have what font sizes, what colours, things like that, proper style guide kind of thing. Is it a component library, or is it going to be a living component library, living style guides, integration into the application? Why are you building it? Is it because you've got 10 sites and you want consistency between all those applications for a component? Is it a deliverable, like we do CLMF quite often, that can be quite effective format of what you want to, how you want to deliver it? Is it just marketing? Quite a lot of component libraries, I think, are actually marketing or ways of hiring people, right? You know, you put a really nice looking component library up, people get quite excited about that. I know several of those tweets or whatever from several designers or developers who said, I actually went to go and work at this place because I think their component library, you know, was so nice, it kind of really enticed me to go and work there. I think there's good cases now, it's quite fashionable, so you know, it can just be a marketing tool. And who's it for? This is something I think that doesn't get thought about a lot, but we have the discussion internally quite a lot. Quite often these are like developer-focused tools. So you're building a component library, a bunch of code, and then the actual UI of it, very focused around, oh, I want to have a look at the code, I want to have a look at this. But there's lots of other players when you're building sites. People, there's project managers, there's maybe stakeholders, builders for a client, lots of stakeholders, and they've all got different needs around what these things are. And quite often you end up with like having a senior stakeholder or something like that, looking at this pattern library, which is a bunch of code basically, and random things. It's not a very, they don't really want to see any of that. They want to see, like, can we, I just want to see what was done in the last two sprints, basically. You know, how do I see just these components and things like that? So is there a way that we can make these component libraries valuable for not just the developers, but for also all these kind of potential users of the system? So organizing and naming stuff, it's always hard. There's infinite ways of chopping your things up, infinite different ways of different things you can call things. We talked about there's this pattern lab style way of doing things, the atoms, molecules, like that. That's quite a structured way of doing things, but it's a documented way of doing things. And if you're not sure about how to split your things up, it provides a really nice framework, a documented framework. You can point people at some documentation, they say, what's a molecule? You can say, this is a molecule. And it's a nice structured way to do things. If it doesn't suit you, don't use it. But whatever you do use, I think it's important that it gets documented, that it's well understood. When you're talking, again, it helps break down this kind of back-end kind of thing, where if I'm talking to a back-end developer and I'm saying component or module or whatever the language is, that they understand what you're specifically referring to for those things. Pick a format. Pick what makes sense to your project. Pick a format and then stick with it. Documentation. So a lot of those sort of component libraries we looked at has a lot of documentation with it. I think it's always when you're starting a project worth thinking about what kind of documentation do I need to generate. So there's documentation, lots of different forms of documentation. There's documentation for the component itself, which is like for an individual component, like what is it? It's a button, it's blue or you know, I think that's self-evident. But and that might live in, you can have that in CSS, you can have that anywhere and pull that out when you're generating the style guide. And then there's implementation documentation, which is like that's the component that's been described. Now how do I implement that? And that might be copy and paste HTML, or it might be copy and paste line, which from the Ruby journal or whatever. But it's kind of just sort of how you implement that documentation that component in the site. And then there's system documentation, which is like as a cohesive whole. How does this thing work, and what's the naming conventions and things like that. And all those kind of documentations, like they've probably got different ways of where they live in your system, how they're generated, probably different needs, you know, in markdown files, things like that. It's all worth thinking about up front before you get into the actual building of it. And then preview UI, I never know what to call this, but it's like, I hope it makes sense when I'm talking about like a rendering over the top of your component library. I kind of, in my mind, these are really two separate things, a code base underneath it and this optional rendering of stuff. but this is, yeah, the web preview, whatever you want to call it. How are you going to build that? Is it an off-the-shelf tool? There's lots of good off-the-shelf tools. Again, this comes into the discussion about naming things and organizing things, because some of those tools have got limitations or impose kind of some structure on the way you need to do things, so you need to think if you're happy with that.
I'm still a bit confused what preview UI is. You mean kitchen sink app?
So
kind of the brochure, isn't it?
Yeah, so basically the way I try and think about it is that under the hood you've got your file system full of files. Mm-hmm. Yeah, which is, now if you were building your application, you would say suck in those files or those would be in your site or whatever, those would be your template files in your application. Now, preview UI is what you build on top of those to be able to browse those things, browse through them. Are you familiar with the sort of style guides and things I've shown there? Yeah, so they're a way of navigating those components and navigating those modules in a browser, basically.
Okay. Yeah. I'll call that kitchen sink.
Okay. Yeah. So it's not your site itself. It's a way of navigating and browsing the things that we've extracted from that site. In a way that is meaningful and makes sense, and that people can use to understand the components and the documentation on them. So,
thank you.
Yeah. Again, language is important. So yeah, I described them one way, but I don't know. Yeah, what actually to call this bit of it, basically. So in your preview UI, when you're browsing a component, there's things you need to think about, the data in there. What data are you going to render the component with? Because it's not in your application. It's probably not putting data out of your database like it would in your application. So how are you going to generate that data now? Most systems that you use in YAML or JSON like to put some preview data in there, basically. But what happens if you want to do a user list and you want to have 1,000 users in that user list, and you want to render that? Do you hand type those 1,000 users? Is there a way you can generate data? Could you put it in from an API anywhere? If your site's already got an API, is there a way you can render your components in a preview UI by pinging the API and getting real data in there? That's a valuable kind of thing. I think you're testing your components with real data in there, which would be very good. Are you going to run a local server or a static site generation or both? And is there any way you can generate different views of this UI for different audiences? Again, if a product owner is looking at this UI, do they need the same thing from a developer? You're looking at this UI and the developer wants to copy and paste the HTML, the product owner wants something different. And then workflow and integration. So this is the last thing I'm mentioning, but I do think you should probably think about this first. Integration is hard, so that's the first thing you should think about. Where your components live, are they a dependency, are they part of the production app, are they part of the preview UI app, kitchen sink app, whatever we want to call it, and does the preview UI need deploying anywhere, what build tools are we using? I hope you haven't come for answers for me. I haven't really got answers, but I've just got lots of questions that I think is worth thinking about when you come to actually build these things. Having said that, I've got a few kind of rules which I try and think about these things. I guess it's more my personal framework thinking about how these things are, might be useful. I think file system first development. So I think about the way I would structure this code if I was just building a bunch of components in a file system without any kind of requirements on them to be rendered in a certain way or pulled into an application. And that means that I can look at this file system and I can understand it without having to have anything rendered around it. So I can look at it, I can see there's a component, which is a directory, it's got a README in it, I can read that README, and I can read it in the pure code, it doesn't need to be written, it's a markdown file or something like that, it's plain text, so I can understand it. I can see if it's got a CSS file or a JavaScript file associated with it. And then build your components like your application. I think if you're building your components, if your application uses handlebars, write your components in handlebars. Make your life easier for yourself. And this is obviously a bigger problem on bigger applications where there is more of a distinct break between sort of front end team and back end team. But if you're using gulp in your component library, use gulp in your application because it just makes life so much easier. And then decouple the kind of finding and rendering logic from the application and your preview UI. So again, if your application needs to go off and fetch a template from somewhere, and you've got another application that needs to fetch that same thing, so you are trying to integrate multiple sites for the same component library. Suck that logic out, put that into a gem or a npm module or something like that, but it means that you don't have to repeat that code across multiple sites, multiple applications, because then if you change the way those components are called in or rendered, you don't need to repeat that. You don't need to repeat that change in multiple places. Beware opinionated tooling, it's not really beware, but it's be wary of opinionated tooling, that some of the tools you, choices you make up front, as we said, have impacts on what comes later. And keep banging the same drum, but integration is hard, so plan for it first. Okay, so this was basically just a big build-up to a pitch for a tool which we've been building. It's not really a pitch, it's not something I'm going to try and sell you anything, but it's, I guess I'd like to quickly talk to you about this tool that we use in ClinF that we've been building for a little while. Not because I think the tool solves all these problems, but because I think that if I can actually explain what this tool is, I'm very bad at explaining what this tool is. I think it helps you get in the mindset of solving some of these harder problems that later on, at least kind of tries to address some of those problems that we've talked about. So I'm going to try and explain it, and I'm going to show you a bit of live code. And I'm really not good at explaining this. I can't seem to simply describe it, say. I'm also really bad at doing keynote slides with diagrams in when I've got some of those, so if you've got any questions, please shout out and I'll try and explain the best I can. It's an open source tool. It's actually been open source for ages, but it's just no one knows about it, so you can go and have a play with it, download it. This very generic description is it's a tool to help you build, document, and integrate component pattern libraries into your web projects. It's written in Node.js. JavaScript. It's basically a lower level tool than a lot of the ones that we've been talking about, in that it at its core it just passes and takes a directory of components and configuration data, a bunch of other stuff, with a few kind of like loose rules around it, and it kind of creates a nice representation of what that means in memory. So it applies some rules to those things. And then it exposes an API, like not an HTTP API, but just to be used as a module in your application and stuff like that, but it provides an API that plugins, tools, sites, applications, whatever, can use to find, access, render components. So this is that abstraction layer that I was talking about with the Ruby gem or whatever. This lets you have assign effectively. You can do things like have a component which is assigned by it, so it's got an ID, and you can say, go render me this component by its ID. It's a file system, it's not a directory, database or anything like that. But that means that you can move that component around in your file system, and it doesn't affect your app, will not break if you move that around. So it means you're free to do things like organize your file system how you want it and reorganize it how you want it, and not worry about the fact that, oh, this is being used in this application in the preview UI, then that's going to break it. It's template language and build tool agnostic, so it will work with pretty much whatever template language you want. It's not completely agnostic, it's written in JavaScript, it's very hard to write. I started wanting to write this like an opinionated piece of software, and it's amazingly how like, every single thing you do is an opinion in it, basically. All of this stuff's opinion, basically. But it can use pretty much any template language as long as it's written in JavaScript. As long as JavaScript has a parser for that template language, so you can pretty much use it. It might need to do a little bit of work, but generally it was pretty cheap. And it can work in any build tool for your assets, doesn't it, by gulp or grunt or anything like that. Supports component level and file system level and system level documentation generation, just about generating docs. And you can define data in different ways, in YAML files, in JSON files as data to do preview rendering, but also you can, it's built on Node, and you define your data as JavaScript, Node, CommonJS modules, so that you can make things like API calls, database calls if you want, do whatever you want in there, and use that to generate the data, which will get something to the UI. And then it has plugins for doing things like rendering a preview layer at the top of everything, so you can browse these things nicely. Workflow commands, so you can write your own custom commands. They're a bit like gulp kind of tasks, which you can write, but it's all aware of the structure of your components and how your components are built. and to render them and so on. So you can write custom export commands and things like that. You can use it by the command line or as an npm module. So, I don't know, it's probably, stop me if this doesn't make sense. This lives in my head for a very long time. This is the first time I'm trying to kind of like explain it to other people. So the way I think of it is that other tools at the moment, quite a lot of other tools, you've got your code, you've got the kind of preview UI, and you've got your site. And they help you do this bit here. They help you author your codes, and they render this out of it. And then they leave you a bit in the cold when it comes to turning these things or importing these things into your site quite often. There's this tool, it's called Fractal. Basically, it works as a thinner layer over the top of stuff. You've got your code organized how you want it, fits your project. And then Fractal basically provides an abstraction layer on top of that file system and exposes a plugin interface as well, so you can write some plugins. And that one of those plugins is a web UI plugin, which generates this kind of nice, what we talk about. There's a pool here in the front row. I'll show you this in a minute. But it can also, it's another plugin which I've made very quickly, a proof of concept, but it also exposes now, this exposes a JSON API which represents a pattern. So you can make, show you later, this is like slash button, and then it will go and find a component that's called button, got an ID or a handle of button, and give you all the data about that component. You can make a post request, doesn't do this yet, but in theory you can post some data to that, get back a rendered component so that your sites that don't use Node or whatever can, it's like what we talked about, the learning panel example, basically like decoupling that. And then you can have multiple sites. This is the same site that I got lazy with screenshotting, but you can have multiple sites that use Fractal itself as it's an npm module, so they can be included in there as a dependency, and they can pull in Fractal, and then you can hand off all the rendering of components and things like that to Fractal. So they don't need to use handlebars anymore. They don't even care what is used, the template language is used in your component library. In fact, you could swap out your component library templating handlebars for React under the hood, and your app would never actually need to know about it. It doesn't care what templating language is there. If you swap out your templates, this can make the same calls to get the same components to render the UI there, and it doesn't need to know anything about the actual structure of your components underneath. Okay, demo time. So give me a second to try. Does that make any sense what I'm talking about? It doesn't until I've actually shown you it a little bit. Please stop me if there's any questions or anything like that.
Made sense to me.
Okay, that's one. Yes. Alright, let's try and do this like this. Let's give this a try. This is the part I'm least prepared, so bear with me. I've got something else. Okay, so let's try and make this a little bit more practical now. So this is a directory which has got some components in it. Yeah. Now those components are organised here into some folders which are called units and patterns. And it's got a bit of the 0-1 is just an ordering thing on there that's just to help order those elements. You can do that in other ways, but that's one way to do it. And then within, say, this units directory, and these could be multiple nested as deep as I want, I've got a bunch of patterns. Now, the patterns can either be just a simple template file, so this is a handlebars template. This hasn't got any placeholders for data in there, but that's literally the simplest representation. Or it can be a directory that's got this is a button here, it's got a bit of code which represents that button. This is a handlebars template, a sort of fairly complex button. It's got some styles in there for that button, and it's got a config file. And in the config file, we can customize the way we can give it some preview data. So this context is data that we use in the UI, And then this is variants of that button. So there might be different, you might want to use that same template, that same button template, but render it with different types of data to show different, like a cancel button, an action button, etc. So this is just a sort of simple example at the moment. So so I'm using it as a command line app at the moment. So type fractal, starts being up, and I get a little, it's got what's called an interactive command line. So it's got its own little sort of environment that these commands can run in. So you don't need to call them from the sort of top level command line. So I can write help and see what commands I've got available to me. And if I run start, say it comes with the built the plugin, the web UI plugin as I call it, is comes built in.
Do you want to move that up to the screen a bit? Because people at the back can't see.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Can you see that?
Yeah.
So now I can go, and this is what we're talking about. This is now rendering my pattern library as a kind of, you know, preview basically. So I can go and browse my patterns here. These are how this is that button pattern. You can see it's those variants, the different types of buttons have been exploded out on the side. So this is pretty much what you get from like Pattern Lab or Fabricator, stuff like that. You get given, you can see the rendered HTML, you can see the view template itself, you can see the context data, that's the data that this particular instance is being rendered with. So this is the data that's being passed into the template to render that particular instance of the button, for instance. This is that heading, it was just a very simple one, there was no context data there. And you can do things like render a whole bunch of components in one view. So these are batched together instead of having them separate. And you can have notes associated. I'm not sure I've got any notes associated with me. So this has got some notes. So you can add notes. So these are the different. So this is documentation just around the implementation of that specific component. So this is a more complex pattern. This is one that actually includes other patterns. So if we look at the view template again, pull that up. So this is importing other templates. Now you notice that this is, I don't know how many people are familiar with that handlebars, but this is using a kind of special notation here in terms of like this at symbol, which basically, this is what I was talking about, referencing things by an ID rather than referencing things by a path. So it's quite powerful because it means that I can redirect, I can move stuff around in that file structure and all my components will still work where it tries to pull these things in. So it gives you a preview layer like that. It, you know, lets you do various things. Like you can make a, you know, small screen, which is a convenience method to use, so I can test everything on my small screen views.
Mark, sorry, quick question. What's the symbolism of the different colour circles next
to it? So that lets you basically have different statuses associated with it. So that's a workflow thing. Basically, you can have you can set your own statuses. It comes by default, I think, ready and work in progress and prototype. So this is work in progress. So basically, if you're handing this over, people you can see, you know, don't implement this yet. It's, you know, it's not ready or whatever, or it's ready to go. If I show you quickly, so. In let's have a look at this form pattern. So it can use YAML for configuration, and I could set that form. You can just set a status to progress, for instance. And now my form, fresh that, it's going to be work in progress. So it's basically just a way of, I mean, it's very basically you can set the colours and things like that up yourself. Now you can do things like, so for instance, for this users list, so I was talking about, long list of users, I don't really want to type all of those out myself, but because you can use JavaScript as a configuration format, I can basically generate that list of users dynamically. So instead of just being YAML where I have to type all those out, I can use JavaScript, generate this. I could also make a database request here if I wanted to make a request to my actual application to pull out actual application data, things like that, which means that you get real data in here, which I think is quite valuable. That's all done here. I won't go into great detail on this because it gets very boring. two people in the front row that have been bored by this many times already. And you can generate documentation. And the documentation is Markdown, but it's also run through a templating language as well. So, this is a docs folder here. I've got my style guides. Now, I can set up some YAML, some like data at the top of my file, which then gets passed into my actual my Markdown file, and I can import other. This is importing a separate partial to generate, basically, like this little swatching thing. So it's quite minimal actually in terms of what it gives you, but you can build on top of it. And the whole idea of the tool is that it exposes some low-level functionality, and you can build other tools on top of it. So just copy and paste this to save me. So it's got this concept of themes, so you can create another theme for it. So this is what I was talking about making it relevant to the audience. You can run multiple themes simultaneously. So for instance, this is not really a very useful debug theme, but it's just something I put together for this to show you that basically you can generate here a debug theme which could have a bunch of information. So it's not that useful at the moment. But about the structure of your component library to help people, when you're authoring the component library, it could be useful information in there about the different components and debugging things that are going wrong. You can provide a rendering and stuff in here, but the themes they don't just provide a skin over the top of it. You've got complete control over the output. You can specify your own URLs and so on. It just gives you a nice easy way to generate, gives you access to all the data about the components so that you can generate your own themes. But maybe you want to have one where they can filter by, you can add tags to your components that you can then filter by a sprint or something like that to see which components they're working on, which sprint, stuff like that. So you can add different themes for different use cases, and it's fairly straightforward to create them. Let's see if that doesn't work. So I said I'm going to talk about React. I don't know really anything about React, but I thought it would be quite nice. So this can use different template languages, basically. By means of an adapter, you can run different languages. So this example is example in this component directory. I've got my handlebars, I've got some React stuff. I've literally ripped these templates straight off the React site, so if this is terrible React, please don't shoot me. And so you can see it there. And this is actually, at the moment, it's just rendering React server-side. So you can see this is I was quite impressed by that. So this is a React component. It's being rendered server side, but you can say it's just. And this is another React component that's pulling in different React components. Now, this is what I mean when it's exposed as an API. So I've included Fractal as an npm module, and that Fractal instance I can then do things like find this component list and give me the view path of that. Now, you might not actually want to do this because, especially in React, you might want to do things in a less fractal dependent way if you're going to use this in your application, or you can use Fractal in your actual application as well. Then it's no problem. But this means that it's always going to get the correct path for this comment list, which means that I can move this comment list around, I can stick it in different folders, do whatever I want with it, as long as I don't change its name or its ID. Basically, you're fine. And again, this is passing data to those React templates, preview data, through, this is YAML being used to render those, and then you can take that same React component, just plain React component, just the same way you would use in your application, and render it with data straight out of your database.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
How do you handle event handlers?
At the moment it's not. At the moment it's just rendering it server-side, but because it gets rendered into a template here, the React engine is a bit of a weird one because it then renders the template through handlebars, so it will stick your components into this preview template. So when you would bundle your React front end code up as you normally would in your site, as a script tag or whatever like that, and then you would put that in here as well. So you have, it's basically like isomorphic rendering of your React.
Yeah, kind of. I'm just sort of maybe we should save this until the end, actually.
As I say, I know very little about React. This was more to get it working like server side. But if this is how you build your, I don't really know how people build React apps. I'm just flagging it now, basically. But I would imagine you bundle your JavaScript up into a script, into a browserified script format that you can then pull in as a script tag. You can explain to me later because that's something I would definitely like to get figured out. But it's more like a proof of concept about being able to render it in different templating languages. It doesn't help you with the building your assets and things like that. It leaves that. There are some convenience things you can do with that, but it leaves that to you to define if you've got a build tool, what build tool you want to use to do that sort of stuff. And then very quickly, I'll just say, so you can include plugins, like this API plugin, which basically, let's see. So in this instance, so I can include plugins, and then I can also write, I apologize, this is quite JavaScript heavy for people that aren't into that, but you can also write custom commands here. So I'm writing this, each file, each fractal instance has what's called a fractal.js file, which is basically like your gulp.js file or something like that, where you configure your fractal instance. So you can tell it where to look for your documentation, where to look for your part, for your components. You can set up a whole bunch of stuff here, but you can also define custom commands and add plugins and things like that. So if I type help here, I'll see that here I've got access to this API plugin, which adds a JSON API to my component library. So if I now do the use the API command, a lot of ports today. If I say pick a, so I've got a button component, so this is just the idea of the button here. This is just a very like proof of concept thing again. This is now a complete JSON dump of everything Fractal knows about that component, about the data it's got, all the different variants it's got, what button, you know, what it's got, what status each of those variants are. So I could use this in my application, or I could render my component through this kind of API format. Or I can do here, so I've got this list commands which expects, it's got some options, so I'm going to say list components, and so this is just listing out my components and their status, and that's a command that I've now just written here, it's a few lines of JavaScript basically to add that. So that's a simple example, but you can basically use this to build tools to fit into your workflow. So that if you've got gulp tasks or so, they can become component aware. You can use Fractal in your gulp tasks. You can do stuff like that, basically. So it's trying to build a lower level way to understand your components and the structure of your components, and then let you build applications or tools on top of that to fit into your application. And as a last example, so if I look at this file zone. I'm sorry, this is very technical for people that are not technical and don't care about this stuff, but it gets me excited. So. So this is now my application, this is my actual application. And I'm basically just importing effectively that fractal.js file in there. And then this is an Express, which is a known web server kind of thing. And this is just saying for the home page, for the this index page, render this. Now, this is not running through the Fractal command line or anything. If I so if I go now node index.js, so this is just would be run as you normally run your application. It's just an example application, basically. And what that's doing is it's getting these users from the database, fake getting the users. It's rendering a view here, which in this view is not something that is in my component library, it's actually in my application. And if I have a look at that, it's just a kind of standard template, talking about the users. But then it's pulling in a component there, and it's using the Fractal app handle syntax to pull in the component by its ID. So it's pulling it out of my component library. But again, my application doesn't need to know anything about the logic of where these things are stored, or how they're rendered, what in the template language they're rendered in. Doesn't care, basically. And then it's going to send that HTML down, so if I, so this now rendering, this is my users component, which we saw here. Now this is with the dummy data that was generated, and then in my application I'm using some real data, I'm getting the login page, uses that same login form, So what you can do is create here an application. And here I've got, this is my developer application here. This is where my developers go to look at stuff, render stuff, you know, build stuff, and where people can go and see the thing. And then my application can use those things directly in there, provided they're using Node.js. If you're not, well, you're in trouble. But it, you can do other things in that case, which you can expose an HTTP API to it and stuff. So it's basically a low-level tool to try and help take a step towards solving some of the problems that we talked about earlier. Yeah. I think that's pretty much it. Better to know. Yeah, it's work in progress. Very few people have kicked the tires on this. We've been using it internally for a while. Charlotte's been exposing bugs, and Paul's been filling up my issues list with even more bugs. But if people want to kick the tires on it, I'm also happy to chat about this. I think it's got to be utility, and I think that at least trying to think about different ways to solve the problem. So if people want to come ping me about it or have a play, and let me know. The documentation's sparse, but getting better. The tests are sparse and not getting better at this point. It's kind of progressed from a proof of concept into something a bit more, so I'm still playing catch up on that stuff. But yeah, that's it. Thank you.